have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship him. We have come into his house, gathered in his name to worship Christ the Lord. Worship him, Jesus Christ the Lord.
Good morning, and let's turn to number 364 and sing Because He Lives.
God sent his son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, the calm assurance this child can face uncertain days because he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross the river, I'll fight life's fight, no war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and honor he brings. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, and life is worth the living just because he lives.
I'll say he is risen, and you say he is risen indeed. He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Praise be to God. Greet your neighbor in the name of the Lord. As you make your way back to your seats, if you would turn over on the back of your bulletin, we do have just a few things to announce. Really just one thing to remember this afternoon for all of you young folks, or if you have grandkids and you'd like to have them be a part of that, or any folks visiting that are young enough to take part. At 1:30 this afternoon, up by the Throckmorton County Hospital, the volunteer fire department will be hosting their annual Easter egg hunt. They'll ring the fire siren about 1:30, and the kids can meet down at the fire station and ride the fire trucks up to the Easter egg hunt and hunt for the eggs and the little prize eggs that they give, and it'll be a lot of fun. So that's going to be happening at 1:30 this afternoon. Is there anything else going on in the community we need to announce this morning? All right, well, what joys can we lift up this morning?
My 93rd birthday,
Minta Seifert. Congratulations, Minta. That's wonderful. What else?
Easter.
That's always a joy, you bet. Easter's a joy. We've had some wonderful rains. The land looks beautiful and green. It's just a blessing. Please don't take that for granted. I talked to my mom that lives up in Clarendon, and out of all this rain that we got down here, they got barely 0.2 inches out of that. And so they're going on close to 180 days there without any measurable rainfall. So it's very, very dry in a lot of places. So it is a joy to be able to say we've had all this rain. So please don't take that for granted. Any other joys to lift up this morning?
Jake.
Yes, we had a great sunrise service. It was a little breezy, but they had a wind break up on the tent, and we all kind of gathered around under there and had our service up on the hill this morning, and that was well attended. And Brian, go ahead and
Yeah, tremendous joy for the Throckmorton School is that they received a notice from the TEA that their application for planning year for early college for Throckmorton had been accepted, and they'll start the planning year this next school year, and hopefully be able to offer the following year an early college for the school, meaning that not only will the students be able to graduate with a high school diploma, but have the opportunity to graduate with up to 60 hours an associate's degree. So I think it's a wonderful opportunity for our school, and to an exciting time for the school to be involved with and have that opportunity.
That is a joy. Amen. Any other joys to lift up? Do what?
Families.
Yeah, great to have all the families here this morning. Glad y'all chose to come and worship with us on this beautiful Easter Sunday. Well, if you would take a moment and look at your list of prayer concerns. Are there any additions or updates? I did get a text concerning Wani Richards. They did do surgery on her Monday and did amputate her arm. Right around the elbow, just above the elbow. That surgery did go successfully. She survived the surgery. She is recuperating still. She's very weak, but she was able to visit with her relatives and communicate with them some. And so just the fact that she's hanging in there and doing that well is a blessing. And so we just need to continue to pray for her and for her family as she recovers from that accident that they were in. It's going to be a while yet before she can even start physical therapy. But they're optimistic on her recovery at this time. So are there any other additions or updates to our prayer list this morning? Yes, ma'am.
My daughter and mom had a wreck yesterday morning. They were traveling in her car. And she bruised up three bands and hurt her chin and her spine. They had a few little bruises, but they were all okay.
Well, praise the Lord. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am. Estelle, your daughter-in-law?
Yes.
Kim Everett had an accident yesterday, totaled her car, but everybody's a little bit banged up, but okay. So we praise the Lord for that. Are there any others this morning we need to update or add to our prayer list?
Jesus.
Let's prepare our hearts to go to the Lord in prayer.
Lord, prepare me to be a sanctuary, pure and holy, tried and true, with thanksgiving I'll be a living sanctuary for
Heavenly Father, we come to you on this Easter morning, grateful and thankful for your sacrifice for us, that we might have life in you, and for the fact that you rose from the dead, conquering death and sin, so that we might have eternal life with you as well. Lord, it's just hard to put into words how grateful and thankful we are for your life and for what you've done for us. Lord, we're thankful for the joys that have been lifted up this morning, for the rain that we've received, for our family, for friends, for just the time that we can come and fellowship one with another and celebrate this time. Help us, Lord, never to take for granted the blessings that you give us each and every day. Food on our tables, roofs over our heads, jobs by which we can provide for our families. We give you thanks and we give you praise. Lord, we pray for these this morning who need to feel your healing touch. We lift up Wani to you. We pray that you would continue to heal her body and surround her family with your love and care. Lord, we're thankful for that Kim Everett and her family were spared any serious injury from this wreck that they suffered yesterday. We just pray for a speedy recovery for them as well. And for all of these on our prayer list, Lord, we lift them up. May you be there for them in the way that they need you the most right now. And help us, if we see names we recognize, to reach out to them in some way this week and show them the love of Christ. Lord, we pray for Throckmorton. We pray for those that are waking up this morning who don't have the hope that we have, who don't have the faith that we have. It's so hard for some of us to even imagine what that might be like. And Lord, we just pray that through our actions and through our deeds and through the things that we do in the community around us, that we would be a light in the darkness for them. Lord, we continue to pray for this nation. We pray for healing. Lord, we pray that our leaders would seek your face and your wisdom as they make decisions that affect us all. And that you would raise your church up in revival, that you would awaken your church to once again be a foundation for hope, the foundation for purpose, the foundation for fullness of life that it once was. And Lord, we pray for our world. All across the world this morning, our Christian brothers and sisters are celebrating Easter. Many are able to do that in a place like this without fear. But there are many who are having to do it in secret for fear of their very lives because of persecution. We pray for your deliverance. We pray for peace. And Lord, when we come to those times when we don't know what to say or even how to pray, help us remember we can always pray with confidence the prayer you taught your disciples when you prayed. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time I'll ask our little children to come, and we'll have our children's message this morning.
Put yours in. Great, you want to put yours in? Yeah. I'll help you in a minute, okay? Good morning. How is everybody? Good. I'm glad that I could get to see you all this morning. I love looking at all your Easter dresses. You want to sit right here, babe? And your little bow ties. Y'all look so nice. Everybody's pretty and handsome. Okay, so some of you were not here last week, so we're going to fill y'all in. We talked about Jesus. He rode into town. Does anybody remember what he rode into town on? Was it a... It was a donkey. It wasn't a big white horse like we think a king might ride in on, but it was a donkey. And then what did they do to welcome Jesus into town?
They used leaves.
Leaves. They waved palm branches to Yes, you did too. Okay, and then to remember, Jesus came into town and he started talking to the people, and there was some people that got a little angry, the Pharisees. Do y'all remember the picture that I showed y'all last week of them with their mad faces? Okay, and then we talked about what happened to Jesus. Brody?
They
scrunched
him up and put him on
and
hung him on the cross.
Okay, they whipped him 39 times and they put him on the cross. Okay, I think I promised. Did I promise, Claire, did I promise you could open an egg today?
I don't know.
Well, come here. I think I promised you that. Okay, so I hope I got the right one. Okay, open it up. Pick it up. Can you show it to everybody? Okay. Show it to all your friends. Can everybody see what Claire has? Kate. Sorry. No wonder she's looking at me funny. Okay, so this is to remind us that Jesus was nailed to the cross. But, so I'm going to tell you... the next part of the story, because we kind of think that this might be the end of the story, but really it's the beginning of a beautiful story. It's just the beginning. So there was a huge stone that had covered the tomb and was rolled away. Okay, Claire, open that one. Okay, show it to everybody. It's a rock, and it's supposed to symbolize the huge stone that they put in front of Jesus' tomb. Why did they put a stone in front of Jesus' tomb?
So nobody would get in there, and he would be safe.
So nobody would get in there, and his body would be safe?
Okay.
Anybody think of any other, do y'all remember any other reasons from the story? Okay, well, Pilate had told those soldiers, you better guard his body and do not let anything happen to him, because we don't want his disciples to take his body and then say, well, he rose from the dead. And those soldiers, they sealed the tomb, and the rock was as big as a car. Think about a rock as big as a car. And those soldiers, you know what was going to happen to the soldiers if they let anything happen to Jesus' body? They knew that they would die. So do you think they guarded it pretty closely? They did. Well, because Pilate didn't want, he said, don't let anything happen to Jesus' body. But the next morning there was a miracle. What was that miracle? Okay, so Jesus rose from the dead. And so because he rose from the dead, he got to go around, and a lot of people got to see and witness that Jesus was alive, and that his promise that he made to us, that we would have life in heaven, it was for real. Right? Okay, so I want you all to be happy today and have fun, and I want you to remember that while you're hunting eggs, I want you to remember that Jesus is alive. And I think, can y'all help me deliver a message this morning? Okay, so what I want us to say is, hallelujah, he's alive. So let's practice, okay? Can everybody say, hallelujah, he's alive.
Hallelujah, he's alive.
Guys, that was kind of wimpy. Let's try it again, okay?
Hallelujah, he's alive.
Okay, that was better. But I want the third time to be the best, okay? So look out there, find your grandparents, or your mom and dad, or find your friends. Can you turn out there and look? Oh, I see some people waving. Okay, so find your family. And wave at them. Okay, now let's hear it. Ready? 1, 2, 3. Hallelujah, he's alive. All right, let's bow our heads right quick. Dear Lord, we just praise you for all these children. We just ask, Lord, that you go with them today. Let them have a great time celebrating their egg hunts and with their family and friends, Lord. Most of all, though, let us just celebrate with them and help them to always remember that the true meaning of Easter is that you loved us so much that you died for us so that we could have eternal life with you in heaven one day. We just praise you and we love you. Amen. All right, y'all have a great day. Have fun.
As the children return to their seats or go to the nursery, if we could have some ushers gather in the back, we'll take our offering. Let us pray. Father, now we just celebrate this time when we can give back to you a little bit of what you've given to us. May we give with cheerful hearts, and may this offering be blessed and multiplied to be used for your glory here in Throckmorton and around the world. Amen.
Please rise to the doxology.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. Our scripture passage this morning comes from the book of John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Hear the word of the Lord. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came along behind him and went straight into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the cloth that had been wrapped around Jesus' head. The cloth was still lying in its place, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to where they were staying. Now Mary stood outside of the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb and saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot. They asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. He asked her, "Woman, why are you crying? Who is it you are looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord." And she told them that he had said these things to her. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Oftentimes when I'm watching the news or reading news accounts on the internet or reading things in magazines or newspapers, I've often said to myself, is there any hope? Have any of you ever said that or felt that way? You look at our society today, you look at our world today, and you wonder sometimes, is there any hope? That's a question that many of us face, and we face it at different times in our lives. Is there hope? Is there any hope for the married couple who seem to wind up at the same dead end of unresolved conflict again and again? Or how about the person who has fallen victim to alcohol, drugs, or gambling, or any of a number of addictive behaviors? Is there any hope for the person who is in so deep that he or she fears that they'll never find a way out? Where's the hope for the mom-to-be who goes to her obstetrician for a routine checkup and hears the words, "I'm sorry, we can't find a heartbeat"? Or for a single mom who works a full-time job by day, serves as both mother and father by night, and wonders to herself, "How long can I keep this up?" Or the person whose dream job turns out to be not their dream job and they find themselves unemployed. Or the person who battles depression or anxiety, or the person who stands by their spouse's bedside as they lay dying. And where is the hope for a generation of young people who seem to be an easy mark for drugs, STDs, abuse, or the pain of a broken family? Where is hope? What is its source? What reason is there to hope? Well, friends, the good news for us as Christians is is that through our faith, there is hope. And it's not a hope based on some optimism that in the end everything's going to turn out right. It's a hope that is based on faith and love. The faith that the God of creation cares about you and me. He cares about us so much that the Bible says every hair on our head is counted. And that not one sparrow falls to the ground without our Heavenly Father knowing about it. And that in the Father's eyes, we are worth so much more than a few sparrows. Our hope is in the love that never fails. The love that pursues us long before we're even aware that we're loved or lovable. It's the love that comes looking for us when we are at the bottom of the ditch. It's the love that weeps for us and with us as we struggle in our brokenness and in our sins. It's the love that goes to the cross in order to show us how great that love is, how important we are, and how powerful is the hope that can conquer even death itself. The hope we have is found in an empty tomb. Amen? A risen Savior and a God who calls us into God's life, God's kingdom, into God's side without us even having to buy a ticket. The hope we have is found in a God who has purchased us with His own blood. The hope we have is in a God who seeks out the hopeless and transforms them. Some 2,000 years ago, early on a Sunday morning, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene, one of the world's hopeless outcasts, went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed. And at that moment, that was just another twist of the knife for Mary. I mean, how much worse could it get? This is just chaos upon chaos. What kind of a cruel trick is this? Someone has taken Jesus' dead body. So she runs back and she tells Peter and she tells John. And like a gunshot start to a race, Mary's words get those guys running and they have to go check it out for themselves. John gets there first and sure enough, the stone is rolled away and the tomb is empty. But he just peers inside. He doesn't go in. And there's a really strange thing in there. The tomb is not completely empty. The linen cloths are lying there. It appears that someone has not only taken Jesus' dead body away, but they've first gone to the trouble of unwrapping it. Why on earth would you do that? Peter, out of breath, gets to the tomb a few moments later. And being Peter, he just runs right on inside. And here's an even stranger thing. The linen cloths are lying there, but the single cloth, the napkin that had been around Jesus' head, isn't with the others. It's in a place all by itself. Someone, having unwrapped the body, a majorly complicated task in itself, has also gone to the trouble of laying the cloths out. As a matter of fact, it looks like the body wasn't picked up and unwrapped at all. It looks like it just vanished, leaving the empty cloths like some balloon when the air's gone out of it. Now, as modern people who like to think of ourselves as sophisticated, we might sometimes forget that the idea that God could raise someone from the dead would be just as difficult for these ancient people to comprehend as it is for us. They weren't stupid. They had seen lots and lots of people die. Never once had they seen anyone come out of the tomb, except for Lazarus. But when Jesus called Lazarus out of the tomb, he still looked like a mummy. Finally, John comes into the tomb after Peter, and the scripture says that he saw and believed. To him, somebody taking Jesus' body away but unwrapping it first suddenly looks stupid and irrelevant. As a matter of fact, it's harder to believe that this would happen than the something quite new that surges up in his heart. It's a different sensation. It's something brand new and exciting. It's kind of like falling in love or hearing the sound of raindrops after a long drought. It's faith. Oh, he had had faith before. He had believed what Jesus had told him. He had believed Jesus was the Messiah, but this was different. He saw and believed. The world had turned the corner. The new creation had become. Jesus was alive. Nothing would ever be the same again. Faith, hope, and love had taken a hold of this disciple, and when that happens to a person, anything is possible. Life in its fullest becomes reality. And the old thoughts, the old worries, the old treasures just kind of fall away just as easily and naturally as Jesus' grave clothes. Resurrection occurs. But Mary had not experienced that yet. And that's how it is with faith, with Jesus, the resurrection and new birth. Jesus comes to each one of us personally. No one else can believe for us. Christianity must be experienced. God must come to each of us in Jesus Christ. And so we find Mary outside of the tomb crying. How many of us have found ourselves standing outside of the tombs of our lives at moments in time, crying? Things that haven't gone our way, failures. Oh, we've tried our best to do it all in our own strength, but time and time again we fail. And we find ourselves standing outside of the tomb crying. Do we dare to look in? And when Mary looks in, she sees two angels sitting there. One at Jesus' head, one at the feet where he lay. And they ask her, "Why are you crying?" And she says, "They have taken my Lord away and I don't know where they put him." And we are told at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there. But she didn't know it was Jesus. She had not yet been spiritually enlightened. She was still looking at things in a worldly way. Her heart had not yet been awakened. So naturally, Mary thought Jesus must be the gardener, and maybe he was the fellow who took Jesus' body away. And then Jesus said to her, "Mary." Jesus said her name. Do you remember when Jesus said your name? Do you remember that moment? That time? Maybe you grew up in church. Maybe you went to Sunday school every time the doors were open, went to vacation Bible school. Maybe you went to church camp or to a revival, and at some point in time, you heard Jesus call your name. When Jesus called Mary's name, instantly she recognized him and she saw him for who he really was. And hope exploded up in Mary just like fireworks on the 4th of July. Jesus, it's interesting that Jesus tells Mary not to cling to him. Could it be that Jesus was warning Mary that the new relationship she was going to be having with him was not going to be like the old one? Jesus wouldn't be going around Galilee and Judea anymore, walking the streets, talking and praying with her. His earthly ministry was just about over. And it would be now up to the apostles to spread the good news. And so Jesus tells Mary, "Go instead to my brothers and tell them." And so guess what? Mary becomes the first apostle. She's the apostle to the apostles. She's the first to bring the news. She's the first eyewitness to the most important event in history. And if someone in the first century had wanted to invent a story about people seeing Jesus, I guarantee you they never would have dreamed of giving the star role to a woman, let alone a ragamuffin outcast like Mary Magdalene, now would they? You know, it's been said, I ask people around the world what they think is the biggest day of the year for Christians, and most people will say that their biggest holiday is what? Christmas. But the true answer is Easter. The true answer is Easter, because without Easter, no one would have ever dreamed of celebrating Christmas. Far from being the dramatic conclusion to the story of Jesus, Easter is the beginning. And you and I are living in the middle of it. Read the first sermons that were ever preached in the early church in the book of Acts. What do they begin with? They make no reference to Jesus' teachings or early life. All of them start out talking about the resurrection. how Jesus died and came back to life. Jesus' teachings in life only take on meaning when we take into full account who the teacher is. That is God's own Son who died and rose again. Like Mary and the other apostles, resurrection is where our faith begins. And that is where we find hope and reason, and a great, great reason to live. Praise God. Amen. Let us pray. Lord, we come to you this day thankful that you are alive. You are not still in a tomb somewhere. You are seated at the Father's right hand, and you will come back again to judge the living and the dead, and you know us each by name, and you have a purpose for our lives. You even know how many hairs are on the top of our heads. That's how well you know us. But Lord, we confess to you sometimes that we don't know you nearly as well as you know us. So we pray on this Easter Sunday that may we begin to grow ever closer to you. And as we go into this time when we even remember your sacrifice on the cross for us, may we recommit our lives to following you and you only. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's kind of an interesting Easter Sunday because it's the first of the month. So not only do we get to celebrate the resurrection of our Lord on Easter Sunday, we get to also remember the sacrifice he made for us on the cross through celebrating Holy Communion. One of the great things I love about communion in our denomination is that we have an open communion table. I know we have lots of guests here this morning, and we want you to know that you're all invited. The invitation is very simple. Christ invites all who earnestly, who love him, repent of their sin, and seek to live for him. That's it. That's the invitation. Okay, so if you love Jesus, if you repent of your sin, and if you're seeking to live a Christian life, then you are invited to come and share in Holy Communion. That's all. And so as we prepare, you can open your hymnals to page 12 if you'd like, or the liturgy will be up on the screen if you'd like to follow along. Hear the invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen. Now the great thanksgiving on page 13. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died, Christ is risen, Christ will come again. Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. With those who are assisting, please come at this time. Take communion by what's called intinction. It is the most ancient form of taking Holy Communion. You'll come down the center aisle. I'll give you a piece of bread. You'll dip it into the cup and then consume the elements. And then if you would like to spend some time at the altar in prayer, you may do so and then return to your seats. So the table of the Lord has been prepared, and you may come as you feel led. Thank you.
Praise song this morning is titled Because He Lives. Amen. I ask if you'll rise and join me in singing. Words will be provided for you on the screen.
Amen. Amen. Let my song join the world.
receive this benediction, may the Lord Jesus Christ, through the power of His Holy Spirit, to the honor and glory of God the Father, bless you and keep you and give you the faith and the hope that you serve a risen King. Amen.
Turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face, and the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.